thank you, Biana.
Thank you, Danny, very much. And I would like to thank, first of all, you for inviting me here and the organizers of this conference. I really feel that this is one of the best conferences I've visited recently, so it's a great success, I think. So thank you for inviting me to give a talk here. So again, as Danny mentioned, I'll be talking about the tumor microenvironment and how it influences the transport of carriers, nanocarriers, in primary tumors and metastatic lesions. And you have heard a lot about microenvironment, and it's a hard hour after lunch, so I'll just try to keep you awake. But you have heard a lot about microenvironment during the past 2 days, and probably in every talk, one of the aspects of the microenvironment was mentioned. Would it be an EPR effect? Would it be different immune components, complement, etc., etc.? But I'll just talk about the differences between the same tumor, which is grown in different lesions. And there are differences, as you will see. And if the tumors, and basically the take-home message that I will, the major take-home message is that if the tumor is growing in different lesions, you need to treat it differently. You need to have different considerations for drug delivery carriers to attack it properly. So let's talk about the realm of drug development. Out of 5 to 10,000 compounds which are being investigated in vitro, only one is getting approved within the 10 to 12, 15 years time frame. And basically, if you want to think about this component, this component, which is from the drug discovery to preclinical, it is related to biophysical barriers which the carrier should bypass when the drug is being developed. Now, in clinical trials, different things can happen and can be related to toxicities, inefficiencies, etc. But in this part, this is basically what I'll be focusing on in my presentation. So the biophysical barriers can be divided into several different scales, starting from molecular scales, which is the up and down regulation of proteins, genetic mutations in the drug targeting and the enzymatic inactivation, cellular scales, MDR resistance, cell cycle and different metabolic factors. Microenvironment scales that I'll be focusing today is the cell-cell signaling, nerve vasculature, adhesion, proliferation, immune cell infiltration, and different body tissues, which is the biodistribution, blood, hemodynamics, and reticular endothelial system. So if we'll think about pre-discovery, this too can be related to the pre-discovery. And when I'm talking about pre-discovery, you basically, the screening of the molecules on the receptor level, on the cell level, etc. And the preclinical, clinical, these are the factors that are most important. Let's talk a bit about cancer hallmarks and tumor microenvironment. So in 2000, Hanan and Weinberg published a seminal paper about cancer hallmarks of cancer, which was further revised recently in 2011, and including four more hallmarks of cancer. So the initial were evading and apoptosis, self-sufficiency in growth signals, insensitivity to anti-growth signals, tissue invasion, metastasis, limitless replication potential, and sustained angiogenesis. Now, the revised version actually included four more factors, which are mainly related to immune function and different things. Now, if we try to allocate the factors which are related to the tumor microenvironment in this, most of the factors which are considered the hallmarks of cancer are related not only to the tumor cells, but to the tumor microenvironment. And this is very important where the tumor cell grow. The tumor heterogeneity actually related not only to the tumor cell, which is one of the big factors, but also to the tumor location and metastasis and organ microenvironment. And the therapeutic outcome can be the physiological resistance to therapy. So it's not pharmacological resistance, but the physiological resistance when the drug cannot really penetrate to affect tumor cells. So this is a clinical problem that we all are trying to solve in nanomedicine, and basically I'll be talking about how different it should be approached in primary tumors and metastatic lesions, especially in the liver, because we also have some work in the brain, but I probably will not have time to touch that. So the first one, the very short, and this was an introduction, but the short take-home message is there's an active dialogue between tumor cells and organ microenvironment, and this is not this type of dialogue, but can be prescribed by tumor cells when the tumor cells actually make the tumor microenvironment suitable for their growth, or it can be the opposite. For example, organ microenvironment can prescribe if the tumor cell will grow there or not. As for example, the works by Fiedler or the works by Paget and seed and soil theory, which was originated in 1889, it says that tumor cell exploit the host microenvironment for growth and survival. So it's the seed and soil hypothesis. And sorry, I'm in bed with this mouse. And basically, it is very important because people who actually work in animal models and who grow animal tumors in animals in different locations, for example, they try to produce experimental metastases in liver, in the brain, in lungs, they know that there are specific cells that will grow only in one organ. So there are you can actually pre-select, and this was done by Josh Fiedler, the studies in the 70s, that you can pre-select a population of cells that can grow only in one organ but will not grow in any other organ. And there are some cell lines, tumor cell lines, very aggressive tumor cell lines, that will never grow in any organ except for the primary location. So and this is very important. This was actually pharmacologically exploited. And there are, I will not go into the details of this table, but this is just a table showing that there are pharmacological options that where people are trying to target specific factors in the tumor microenvironment, not in the tumor cells. So this is not the cell division. These are factors in tumor microenvironment. The most famous probably is VEGFR inhibitors and PDFR. But there are also a list of FDA-approved and in different phases of clinical development. There are also other drugs that can be grossly divided into affecting the extracellular matrix, vasculature, and immune component of the tumor. So, in the current presentation, I'll also focus on the same components, but describe them in the terms of transport phenomena in this system. So not targeting the specific pharmacological functions of this tumor niches, but describing, for example, vasculature, accounting for the differences in the blood flow in the tumor tissue, immune component, utilizing cells in the tumor microenvironment for targeting. And ACM, again, I probably will not be able to talk about that, but this is very interesting story about how you can actually exploit the serum biomarkers, which show you how the basal membrane is permeable in order to personalize if the specific person will be susceptible to the nanotherapy. So not everyone is susceptible to nanotherapy. We know that nanotherapeutics will not permeate any tumor. However, there are several biomarkers that you can actually test in the blood, for example, MMP9 and TIM1, and their ratio will prescribe if you can predict that the specific person in the specific tumor location will be susceptible to this therapy. So let's talk about angiogenesis, and the topic was discussed several times already. However, mainly talking about angiogenesis, people talk about primary tumors. Okay, so this is a seminal paper that was published in 2003 by McDonald and Choike. You can see that if you compare primary tumor with tumor metastasis, this is a primary tumor, all of them are primary tumor. So this is the normal vasculature, this is the primary tumor, this is the normal vasculature, this is the primary tumor. So the main thing that you actually see is that there are more blood vessels. So the primary tumors are usually hypervascularized. Of course, the vasculature, as it is known, it's very chaotic and not organized, and the blood flow is not unidirectional. However, still, you see much more vascularization in the primary tumors, and this is one of the how the tumor actually grow. Now, starting from 90s, Rakesh Jain actually published a series of great papers about similar things. And one of the main statements in these papers was that, as a matter of fact, various tissue uptake studies have found the vascular permeability of tumors to be significantly higher than that of normal tissue. So here you can see actually the vascular permeability coefficients. Sorry, again. In different normal tissues and tumor tissues. And in general, as you've seen before, and this is basically the EPR effect that we're talking about and was confirmed by Maeda, and the Doxil is working on the same effect, you can see that the vascular permeability coefficients, because of the gaps in the endothelial cells produced by the tumor tissue, are much higher in the tumor tissue than in the normal tissue. Again, we're talking about primary tumors here. So, talking about tumor heterogeneity, so let's see that the normal skin, and I hope that you can see, because I know that I'll have many images which are will be hard to see in the slide, but let's see how it works. Normal skin and melanoma, you see that the vascularization is absolutely overgrown here. Even with the naked eye, you don't need a microscope for that. So primary tumor in the sacrum, you see that the vascularization here, which is labeled in the green, is different from that in the liver metastasis area. So the circular area is actually the tumor area. So in the liver metastasis, you don't really see the blood vessels. Normal brain, 41, this is breast cancer metastasis in the brain, and 41 liver metastasis. You see that the CD31, which is stained in red here, is very different, and CD31 is the marker for vascularization. So let's see the human tumor. So this were tumors in mice that we did. I'm sorry, this is gross, but let's see the liver metastasis. So everyone who saw the liver is red. Liver is a red tissue. Why? Because it's one blood vessel. Okay, so it's a huge blood vessel. You can consider it this way, because the sinusoids basically they don't even. I mean, you can consider it a huge blood vessel. Now, why do you see the white spots here? It's because the tumor lesions have much less vascularization than the liver tissue itself. Okay, so, and this is basically the breast tumor, which is grown in the primary location and in the liver metastasis. So what do you see in the primary location? Actually, in the primary location, you can see that there is a huge, huge presence of the blood vessels, which was not initially there. And this basically what we see from most of the studies that were published. You know, the primary tumors, the hypervascularization, etc. However, in liver metastasis, it's not the same. So the pattern that we need to consider here is different. Now let's see about the tumor blood flow. So again, I hope you can see that. The blue spots which are moving, these are erythrocytes, and this is intravital microscopy experiments. In primary breast tumor and in liver metastasis. So if you cannot really see that, I will just point. In the primary tumor, there is a very massive blood flow which goes through the tumor tissue. So this is the path, and you see a lot of erythrocytes which are flowing in the tumor tissue, consistently with what I showed before. what's going on in the liver metastasis area. So this is the liver metastasis area. And basically, the tumor here, and you see that the blood flows on the edge of the tumor. It doesn't go in the tumor. So there is no erythrocytes that go in the tumor. What does it mean? So take home message number two, differences in biophysical factors. And you've seen that there are clear differences in biophysical factors between tumor growing in distant location. You need to think about various delivery system considerations. So you need actually to consider that you, for the primary location, should be one, the type of delivery systems, for example, Doxil or other things which will be more suitable. And probably for the liver metastasis, you need to think about something else. So, again, this slide was in different versions, was present in different presentations. So targeting tumors, you can do it based on the biological components, receptor on tumor cells, cell tumor microenvironment. Targeting physical characteristics, which is EPR effect and geometry governed, combining both, and externally activated system, which Yossi talked today. Again, most of this were somehow covered and is actually excellently covered with the previous talk. So I decided to focus on this component, which was less covered. I'll talk about geometry, and Paolo De Cuzzi will talk tomorrow about that, because he's the one who actually produced the mathematical models for that. He'll talk in more details about that. So geometry in nature. There are different objects in the circulation which have different geometries. And you very rarely see spherical objects in the circulation. And that's because these objects have different functions based on their circulation. For example, if the erythrocytes, and this is not only geometry, this also depends the elasticity of the particles. So the physical characteristics of the particulates in the circulation actually prescribe what they will do. Now, if, for example, the leukocytes need to infiltrate the lesion, they will be much more elastic and they will be much more deformable. The same with viruses and bacteria. They usually are not coming with spherical shapes. They are more elongated. They need to circulate. They need to evade, etc. RBC, when they are ready to be processed, they actually change their geometry a bit and their elasticity. And that one of the factors which prescribes that these cells are ready to go. So, and there are several geometry-covered biological processes, which are the hemorrhology, adhesion to vascular walls, and intracellular uptakes. And again, Paolo is going to talk about that tomorrow. I will be switching a bit to porous silicon, and this is because this is the carrier system we are using for accurately doing the different geometries based studies. So porous silicon in biomedical research is not a common thing. That's why I just decided to give you a few slides of introduction why it should be used. It was discovered in 1956 in Bell Systems Laboratories by Uchler, and then the photoluminescent properties and biodegradation and bioactivity were actually found by Cunningham in different stages of the research, and this is also came from Bell Laboratories. So Bell are actually the pioneers in porous silicon research. And the number of publications in PubMed, so PubMed, obviously, this is the medical research-related publications, because before that there were mainly engineering publications. So silicon is, you have everybody has silicon technologies, everybody have in their pockets, it's, you know, all this cell phones, etc. These are microelectronics. So the biological applications are actually growing and growing very fast. It can be evidenced by the publications in the PubMed. Now, I'll be talking about injectable drug delivery system. However, the porous silicon can be used also for tissue engineering, diagnostic separation devices, implantable devices, etc. So there are five factors that we are considering when talking about something that can be used for as a drug delivery system. Of course, these are very important factors, the three of these. Reproducibility and ability to scale up. And Hazy actually brought this point yesterday. You need to be able to reproduce your delivery system and be able to bring it to the clinic. Otherwise, you cannot do that. Biodegradation, biocompatibility. So, as I mentioned, the porous silicon particles are fabricated by the technologies which are on the market for microelectronic devices, and that's why this is photolithography and electrochemical etching. That's why these technologies are very robust and produce very, very uniform particles, as you can see here. And there are a number of publications about that. So scaling up, obviously, there are works by Zhu Liu, who actually produced these pillars, and he can actually produce a large number of these particles from single wafer. And now currently they're working on the GMP procedures for these particles, so it can go to clinical trials. Degradation, this is the main question that I've been asked usually, I'm being asked usually in the presentations, and the degradation of porous silicon is basically well known. The silicon which is non-porous is not degradable. However, silicon which is porous, it usually has the modifications of the hydrophilic, so the surface of the porous silicon is usually modified for with the hydrophilic moieties, for example, even it has been oxidized, because originally it is highly lipophilic, and it's being oxidized or uptest modified, so it's a positively charged, or it can be modified with anything else, like pegylated or attached with any antibodies, and it is actually degradable based on different factors. Like geometry, pore size, and surface modification. So the particle size, porosity, and peg lengths actually influence degradation rate differently. And this is important also because degradation rate in this case will prescribe the delivery rate of the drug. So biocompatibility, it's a very large issue, and I'm not going to talk about that, but just to make sure, just to tell you that we've done extensive studies about that in different mouse models and in vitro cultures with immune cells and endothelial cells and other cells. So, particles, though they are pretty big, they are uptaken by the cells, they don't interfere with the division of the cell, so you can actually load up to 20 particles, 40 particles actually per cell, and they don't interfere with the division of these cells, they don't interfere, they don't produce inflammatory cytokines, so they are very well tolerated. Sorry. Okay, rational design, again, talking about geometry. Because we are doing that using the photolithography procedures, we can finally control the size and shape of the particles, surface modifications, the porosity, which will be the main factor for loading. And this is, I'm coming to this point, it's a multi-stage delivery system. So we are loading second stage, smaller nanoparticles into the pores of this system in order to overcome different barriers. So one first stage is based on the geometry, and it will target specific components in the tumor microenvironment, like vasculature or immune cells. And from this first stage, the smaller particles will be released to the microenvironment to affect the tumor cells. So this is just a schematic presentation of blood flow and let's say liposomes. So why the rheology is important? So when the particles are small, they tend to stay in the middle of the bloodstream, and and less attached to the endothelial walls. Now, the shape effects of the particle actually prescribe them to go to change their trajectory. So if the particles are not spherical, they are much easier attaching to the endothelial wall, and this is the so-called the physical targeting effect. Now, we have shown that in different publications. One of that is, I'm going to talk a bit here, and this is the, can I just have this, because it's always, oh my. So, based on the geometry of the particles, you can actually attain up to 10% of the injected dose per gram tissue in the tumor, only just by changing the geometry of the particle. So with when you are comparing the discoidal particles with spherical particles, for example, of the same diameter. So these are the spherical particles. These are the discoidal particles. You can see that up to 5 times higher accumulation can be seen in the tumor just based on the geometry of the particle. And this is a very interesting finding. Now, in the tumor, the particles are associated with different cell populations, and we checked, for example, macrophages and endothelial cells. And again, we're talking about different environments. So in the tumor, the 0.6 micron in diameter particles, which are the discoidal particles, they are associated equally with macrophages and endothelial cells, so it's about 50 to 50%. In the liver, most of the particles are associated with macrophages, as we expected, and in the lung as well, because these are the organs of the RAS system, and this is what is expected. So this is important because you can actually target specific cell populations in different organs based on the environment of the organ. So what we can reach with just changing geometry of the particle. It's beta margination in the tumor lesion, beta attachment to blood vessel wall, shape of enabled APR, because even though these particles are big, and they are bigger than usually reported gaps in the vasculature, actually, because the maximum that was reported about 700 nanometers, we do see them inside the tumor, which was interesting by per se. Delivery with blood monocytes. So this was the physical component. So just by changing geometry of the particle, you can actually change their fate. So if we combine both, so in this case we use geometry and targeting moiety. In this specific publication, we use bacteriophage targeted again crackle. Crackle is the peptide which is excreted from the tumor cells. This is intracellular peptide. However, it is excreted to the tumor microenvironment and binds to the beta-1 integrin connector protein. So it's actually present on the endothelial cells. And what you can see here is because these assemblies have bacteriophage and gold, as you can see from the SEM images, which are bound to the electrostatically to the silicon particles. You can see that there are changes in absorbance when the nano assemblies are used as compared to gold particles. As well as you can actually have the very specific Raman detection of these particles. Now, when these particles are injected, which is very important too, they remain intact in the circulation, and we have seen that based on the different spectral analysis of the tissues that were taken up from the mice. Now, let's talk about the targeting here. So, when the crackle-targeted BASP were injected to tumor-bearing mice, we can actually detect that S1MP is only the silicon particles. This is the untargeted assembly, which is based on the phage, and but it doesn't have the targeting moiety. And crackle-targeted BASP is the phage which has the targeting moiety. Now, this is the interesting thing that graph that I want you to look at. Actually shows the biophysical and differences between biological and physical. So crackle targeting targeted BASP, the velocity of the particles in the tumor, that means they're tumbling based on the intravital microscopy, is 11 micrometers per second. Now, when the particles are covered with the network of phages, you actually have some type of cloud which prevents the particles. So the tumbling is slowing down. So in this case, there is no targeting. However, the tumbling of the particles, so their velocity in the tumor, is actually slowing down by the factor of 10. However, when you combine the two, when you do this was the opposite way. So S1MP is very fast, and when you do the velocity goes down, and when you do the biological targeting together with physical targeting, the factor it's actually slows down the particles by the factor of 10, which means that the particles have much higher probability of attaching to the specific lesions in the tumor microenvironment which express crackle on their surface. So nanovector geometry, the primary tumor targeting, can be achieved. Breast and pancreatic and ovarian tumors were tested for that. Probably skip that. This is one of the works that we are doing. We are currently doing, and this is basically having the particles, silicon particles, as templates for covering them with polymers. So these are we're using the silicon particles as sacrificial templates, and producing cell mimicking nanovectors. We are covering them with the networks of different polymers, and we dissolve the core. So the core is the silicon, then it's being covered with the core shell, this is the core shell component with this layer by layer polymers. In this case, the methylamine acrylic acid and PVPON. You can use different layers to achieve different elasticities of the particles, and then the core is being dissolved, and only the capsule is remaining. And these are actually the particles that are produced by this technology. They really resemble cells because they are hollow. They are hollow particles which hold the geometry. And you can also actually control the geometry and elasticity in this case, as well as the pH responsiveness. As you know, in tumors, the pH is different. And the goal here was that when the particle sees the tumor microenvironment and actually becomes smaller and can squeeze into the tumor, and basically by squeezing in, it also will release some drug due to the physical components. And we see that we can achieve the almost twice squeezability of the particles. These particles can also go, because of their elasticity, they can go through the pores, which are three times lower than their nominal diameter, and remain intact. So this is the other interesting thing is that it was also mentioned before, is that these particles, they have much less interactions with macrophages, so with the cells of immune system, just because they are elastic. Okay, so again, here we have exactly the same chemistry on the surface of the particles, because the particles are created with the same polymers. The only thing that we're changing here is the elasticity of the particles. So we have the same coverage, but one particles are core shell, which are the rigid particles covered with the same layers of the polymers, and elastic shell are the particles which are dissolved, the core is dissolved. And you can see that actually rigid particles and elastic particles, they react very differently with tumor microenvironment. Now, coming back to liver metastasis, and this is just to remind you that the flow in the liver metastasis is different. So we need to take a different consideration in this case. However, you can see this spots, blue spots, which are not moving. And this is a matter of technique. So we are labeling red blood cells. However, when you label red blood cells and let them be there for, so let the mice be there for 3 or 4 days, what you can see is that the red blood cells which are degraded, they are uptaken by the macrophages. So these are the macrophages which are the static cells. In this case, these are macrophages which are being labeled with the same technique. Now, let's talk about permeation in the case of liver metastasis. So, this I hope you can see. This is a tumor lesion. And these are the dextrans that were injected intravenously. And as I mentioned before, liver is a huge blood vessel. So you can actually see that the whole liver itself is being colored by the dextrans. So it's being colored, and there are two different types of dextrans, 3 kilodalton and 40 kilodalton. However, the lesion itself is absolutely blank. So we need to think how we can actually deliver the drugs to this lesion, because this is basically, that's why, this is one of the reasons why we cannot really treat very well liver metastasis. And again, these blue spots are the macrophages. So we were thinking that basically the macrophages in the liver, they characterize very well any type of liver lesion, also the primary tumors and the liver metastasis. So our thought was that you can actually target liver metastasis by targeting the macrophages. When you are talking about geometry, in the case of liver metastasis, doesn't apply. So if in the primary tumor, the effect of the changing from discoidal to spherical particles of the same diameter was 5 times higher accumulation in the tumor lesion, in the liver metastasis, there is no significant change. So our hypothesis was that the macrophages around the cancer lesion serve as a depot for the therapeutic particles which will release a nanodrug to affect cancer cells. Now we chose the nanodrug that actually is currently in the clinic, and this is Abraxane. This is paclitaxel protein-bound nanoparticles, and it is indicated for metastatic breast cancer, metastatic lung cancer, pancreatic cancer, and ovarian cancer at this point. And it has its own mechanism of transporting. So it basically was approved based on the transport mechanism, that the albumin binds to the calveolin receptors, and it has been transcytosed to the through the endothelial barrier. So we tried to load these particles with the Abraxane. So our MSP particles with Abraxane, which is, at the beginning we thought that can be done because our particles, the maximum pore size is about 70 nanometers. However, when and the Abraxane, when you are reading the leaflet, it says that the particles are somewhere between 120 to 130 nanometers. However, when you dissolve them in the in water or PBS, the dispersion is about 10 nanometers. Because the particles are actually disintegrated to the albumin molecules and the paclitaxel bound to them. So we loaded the FITC albumin or Abraxane inside the particles. I don't know if you can see here again, but we got a very high loading efficiency of the MSV Abraxane into the particles based on the charge of the albumin in the specific pH that we are using for loading. The zeta potential of the initial particles was positive, of our multi-stage vectors was positive, and the final zeta potential was negative, which also evidenced that we got the efficient loading capacity. Now, after that, we checked if the multi-stage vectors with Abraxane are accumulated inside the liver metastasis of 41 tumors. And we have seen that CD68 is the marker for macrophages. These are our particles are in red. And you can see that it very efficiently accumulated in the macrophages as we expected. So the plasma concentration was not different between the two systems when we checked it by LC-MS. However, the liver accumulation was much more efficient. It was about three times more efficient in the case when the particles were combined, MSV particles was combined with Abraxane. Now, the interesting point here is that Abraxane is a cytotoxic drug. So in order to load some cells and that they will serve as cell carrier, you need to make sure that these cells are actually not being killed by the drug. And as you know, macrophages are finally differentiated cells, and they don't divide anymore. So because the cells do not divide, the macrophages, if you load them with much higher concentrations of the MSV Abraxane or just treat them with Abraxane, they actually are very insensitive to the drug. So that means that these cells can actually bear the drug for a long time and survive. And this is not the same with cancer cells, obviously, because these cells, and you can see that the scale here is 0 to 5 milligram per milliliter, microgram per milliliter, and this is the scale here is until 50 or 100 with abdominal macrophages and human primary macrophages. In both cases, we use primary macrophages in this case because cultured macrophages are different. So we try to see in a physiologically relevant model, which means that we put the co-culture of macrophages and cancer cells, and as you've seen, the accessible macrophages are on the edge of the tumor. Accessible means that macrophages which can uptake the particles from the circulation because the circulation doesn't go in the tumor. So the particles were incubated with these macrophages, and we have seen that when the and then washed after a while, because this is what happens in the circulation. The particles are being washed with the circulation. And we have seen that this is a very clear effect of MSV when the particles are, when Abraxane particles are encapsulated in the MSV. You can actually see that the MTTSA for the tumor cells shows that the tumor cells are dying. Now, we actually confirmed it further with the quantitation of the macrophages at TPO for Abraxane in vitro, and this is an in vitro evaluation. And we confirmed it was using the LC-MS, seeing that the quantity in the macrophages after the incubation of MSV Abraxane after 1 day and 2 days, and only the Abraxane after a couple of days. And the same when it is really so, we actually took the medium out of the macrophages after washing them and saw how much Abraxane is being released after this drug is being incubated with the delivery system we're proposing and as compared to the plain Abraxane. And as you can see, there is a three times difference between the system in both cases, which indicates that you can actually release the drug from macrophages. And this is the drug which will further affect tumor cells which are in the proximity of the macrophages. So then we tested the cell viability, and we have seen that MSV Abraxane, which is released to the conditioned medium of the macrophages and pre-incubated with 41 cells, which is breast cancer cells, is actually therapeutically active, much more than the Abraxane itself. And we've seen that this is a ongoing research. We think that the mechanism which is involved in that, and USC talked about inhibiting efflux pumps for the cancer cell, but in this case, this is a positive impact because we want the drug to go out of the macrophages. And we've seen that the incubation of MSV abraxane with the macrophages actually increases the activity of the efflux pumps, the PGP efflux pumps in the macrophages, which probably is the mechanism of the release of the drug to the tumor microenvironment. So let's see what's going on therapeutically wise. So we checked a few therapeutic models. I'll show here the results from breast cancer model. In this case, the cells, again, we are working with orthotopic tumors. So the cells are injected in the spleen and then disseminated from there using the portal vein to the liver. This is the physiologically relevant model of liver metastasis. And I will talk about breast cancer liver metastasis and lung cancer liver metastasis model. We are now doing studies with Carlotta and Kenji with the pancreatic cancer liver metastasis model, and I'm not going to show it here. But basically, the results are very similar. So the factors that we tested in this study, the efficacy study, were the proliferation, apoptosis, and tumor size. And the treatment was done twice within a 2 weeks period. You can see that in terms of proliferation, which are the, I don't know if you can see, but these are, you should believe me, the pink spots. The apoptosis are green spots, but you can see the quantification here because probably you cannot see the markers themselves here. And the tumor size, these are the lesions which are stained in the H&E slides. So the proliferation, apoptosis, and tumor size were significantly different and significantly better when MSV abraxane was delivered as compared to abraxane. The survival of the mice was also significantly extended using Kaplan-Meier. You need to think that these are extremely aggressive tumors. So usually mice die within, you can see here that the mice die within somewhere between 2 weeks to probably like 1.5 weeks to 2 weeks is, from the initiation of the treatment. And this extension of almost a week is a very substantial in this type of tumors because tumors growing extremely fast. Very similar results were received also with the 3LL, which is the lung cancer liver metastasis. So the control abraxane, MSV abraxane, the proliferation index was much lower with MSV abraxane. The apoptotic index was much higher, and the tumor size was much lower with MSV abraxane treatment. And again, here the extension of the survival was significant when the mice were treated with MSV abraxane. Again, very aggressive tumors. And a very interesting thing that we also noticed is that the migration of the macrophages bearing the MSV abraxane, this is one more transport mechanism that we're thinking of, is actually extended additionally to the fact that the macrophages can be a depot for the abraxane surrounding the tumor lesion. You can actually extend the migration of the macrophages inside the tumor lesion. We are thinking, and this is what we are exploring, the mechanism that since the macrophages release some drug into the tumor lesion, when they take and uptake and bear MSV abraxane, you actually create some apoptotic processes inside the tumor lesion, and then these signals are being, there is like a turnover, which actually the apoptotic cells which are dying here, they attract more macrophages. And you can actually see that the macrophages are being recruited to the center of the tumor lesion when they bear the drug. So macrophages as a depot in liver metastasis. So I've shown that MSV abraxane accumulate in the macrophages in the liver, and it's delivered, the macrophages can serve as a depot and slowly release abraxane near the tumor cells. Abraxane is released from macrophages and is biologically active. We have seen the significant increase in therapeutic indices for breast and lung cancer, liver metastasis, and the survival of the mice significantly increased as well. Sorry? Yes? Just to summarize, in primary tumor and liver metastasis, there are two different lesions. Even if they are growing from the same exact cell population, there are different physical factors which gather the accumulation of nanovectors in this lesion. In the primary tumor, it's mainly hemorrheology and adhesion to vascular walls, association with cells. However, in the liver metastasis, is a Kupffer cell or macrophage uptake and association with other phagocytic cells. It can be also endothelial cells, which are also phagocytic. And the last take-home message is that the efficient therapy should build on the specific features of the tumor microenvironment, regardless of the tumor origin. So even that if the tumor is originated, in both cases, it was, for example, breast tumors, and I have not shown the results for lung tumors, but we also have the primary lung tumors, you need also to consider where this tumor is disseminated in order to choose specifically what are the structures you want to target in the tumor microenvironment in order to have a specific and better therapy. Just acknowledgements. Again, Danny, thank you very much. The students and research fellows, colleagues and... Huh? Actually, yes. Well, I've not shown the results that we had together, but sorry. Yes, we're collaborating with Danny as well. Colleagues and collaborators, Mauro Ferrari, Kenji Yokoi, Paolo is here. Again, I didn't show the results that Carlota produced, but she is also part of the team. Thank you very much.